The Boy in the Box is the name given to an unidentified murder victim, 4 to 6 years old, whose naked, battered body was found in a cardboard box in the Fox Chase section of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, on February 25, 1957. He is also commonly called America's Unknown Child. His identity has never been discovered, and the case remains open to this day. In February 1957, the boy's body, wrapped in a plaid blanket, was found in the woods off Susquehanna Road in Fox Chase, Philadelphia. The naked body was inside a cardboard box which had once contained a bassinet of the kind sold by JCPenney, today's popular clothing store. The boy's hair had been recently cropped, possibly after death, as clumps of hair clung to the body. There were signs of severe malnourishment, as well as surgical scars on the ankle and groin, and an L-shaped scar under the chin. The body was first discovered by a young man who was checking his muskrat traps. Fearing that the police would confiscate his traps, he did not report what he had found. A few days later, a college student spotted a rabbit running into the underbrush. Knowing that there were animal traps in the area, he stopped his car to investigate and discovered the body. He was too reluctant to have any contact with the police, but he did report his find the following day. The police received the report and opened an investigation on February 26, 1957. The dead boy's fingerprints were taken, and police at first were optimistic that he would soon be identified. However, no one came forward with any useful information. The case attracted massive media attention in Philadelphia and the Delaware Valley. The Philadelphia Inquirer pressed 400,000 flyers depicting the boy's likeness, which flooded the area and were included with every gas bill in Philadelphia. The crime scene was combed over and over again by 270 Police Academy recruits, who discovered a child's blue corduroy cap, a child's scarf, and handkerchief, all clues that sadly lead nowhere. The police even went so far as to distribute a post-mortem photograph of the boy fully dressed and in a seated position, as he may have looked in life, in the hopes it may lead to a clue. Despite the publicity and sporadic interest throughout the years, the boy's identity is still unknown today. The case remains unsolved. On March 21, 2016, the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children released a facial reconstruction of the victim and added him onto their database. Many tips and theories have advanced in this case, although many of these have been dismissed. Two theories have excited considerable interest amongst the police and media, and they have been extensively investigated. The foster home theory. This theory concerns a foster home that was located approximately 1.5 miles from the site of the body. In 1960, Remington Bristow, an employee of the medical examiner's office, who doggedly pursued the case until his death in 1993, contacted a New Jersey psychic who told him to look for a house that matched the foster home. When the psychic was brought to the Philadelphia Discovery Site, she led Bristow directly to the foster home. Upon attending an estate sale at the foster home, Bristow discovered a bassinet similar to the one sold at JCPenney. He also discovered blankets hanging on the clothesline that were similar to the one in which the boy's body had been wrapped. Bristow believes that the boy belonged to the stepdaughter of the man who ran the foster home, and that they disposed of his body so the stepdaughter would not be exposed as an unwed mother. He theorized that the boy's death may have been an accident. Despite the circumstantial evidence, the police were not able to find any definitive links between the boy in the box and the foster family. In 1998, Philadelphia Police Lieutenant Tom Augustine, who was in charge of the investigation, and several members of the Vidoc Society, a group of retired policemen and profilers, interviewed the foster father and stepdaughter whom he had married. The interview seemed to confirm that the family was not involved in the murder. The foster home investigation was closed. A DNA test taken later on also showed that the stepdaughter was not the boy's mother. Our second theory is the woman known as M. Another theory was brought forward in February 2002 by a woman identified only as M. Police considered M's story to be plausible, but they were troubled by her testimony, as she had had a history of mental illness. When interviewed, neighbors who had access to M's house denied that there had been a young boy living there. They said that M's claims were ridiculous. M claimed that her abusive mother had purchased the unknown boy, whose name was Jonathan, according to her, from his birth parents in the summer of 1954. Subsequently, the boy was subjected to extreme physical and sexual abuse for 2.5 years. He was then killed in a fit of rage by being slammed to the floor after vomiting in the bathtub. M's mother then cut the boy's long hair, accounting for the unprofessional haircut, which police noted in their initial investigation. The boy's body was then dumped in the Fox Chase area. M went on to say that they were preparing to remove the boy's body from the trunk of a car. A passing male motorist pulled alongside to inquire whether they needed help. The two women ignored the would-be Good Samaritan while being careful to shield the car's license plate from his view. The man then eventually drove off. This story corroborated a confidential testimony given by a male witness in 1957, who said that the body had been placed in a box previously discarded at the scene. Forensic artist Frank Bender developed a theory that the victim may have been raised as a girl. The child's unprofessional haircut, which appeared to have been performed in haste, was the basis for the scenario, as well as the appearance of the eyebrows having been styled. Bender later released a sketch of the unidentified child with long hair, reflecting the strands found upon the body. Following the 59th anniversary of the discovery of the boy's body in 2016, two writers, one from Los Angeles, California, the other from New York, explained that they believed they had discovered a potential identity from Memphis, Tennessee, and requested that DNA be compared between the family members and the child. The lead was originally discovered by a Philadelphia man and then developed and presented, with the help of Hoffman, to the Philadelphia Police Department and the Vidoc Society in early 2013. In December 2013, Romano became aware of the lead and agreed to help the man from Philadelphia and Hoffman to personally obtain the DNA from this particular family member in January 2014, which was quickly sent to the Philadelphia Police Department. Local authorities confirmed that they would investigate the lead, yet they stated that they would need to do more research on the circumstances surrounding the link to Memphis before comparing the DNA. The boy in the box was originally buried in a potter's field. In 1998, his body was exhumed for the purpose of extracting DNA, which was obtained from enamel on a tooth. He was reburied at Ivy Hill Cemetery in Cedar Brook, Philadelphia, which donated a large plot. The coffin, headstone, and funeral services were donated by the son of a man who had buried the boy in 1957. There was significant public attendance and media coverage at the reburial. The grave has a large headstone bearing the words, "America's Unknown Child." City residents keep the grave decorated with flowers and stuffed animals to this day. So what are your thoughts and theories on what truly happened to this poor young boy? Do you have any ideas about his identification and true identity? The case of a Pomeranian noblewoman who was beheaded and then burned at the stake after being convicted of witchcraft is being reviewed by academics nearly 400 years after her execution. The truth about Sidonia von Bjork, her crimes, and her grisly end have attracted attention throughout the centuries since her death. But now a team from the Pomeranian Museum in Greifswald, Germany, want people to have a better understanding of the femme fatale. Our goal is to free the history of Sidonia from myths and legends. Describe her case based on sources stored in archives in Poland and Germany. Publicize the statements of experts and encourage the inhabitants and guests of the region to explore its fascinating history, which she is an ambassador of. Dorota Makrutsky, who initiated the project at the Pomeranian Museum, said, "Sidonia was born in 1548 in Schreimsiel Castle to the Bjork family, which lived in the city of Stettin, now known as Sesen. Her family was noble and wealthy, but her father, Count Otto Bjork, died when she was only 3 years old. The castle in which she was born, also known as the Wolf's Nest, had been slowly falling into despair, and the family, running out of funds, had to leave the castle. While living at the Saxon court, Sidonia became engaged to the first of a reputed 15 fiancés, to Prince Ernest Ludwig. Unfortunately, his family refused to let him marry Sidonia, and it was arranged that he would marry a woman from a richer family. It is alleged that Sidonia put a curse on his family, the Griffisi dynasty, the last of which died in 1660. The decline of the Griffisi, or Griffin family, left a power vacuum in the region and led it to being divided between Germany and Sweden. After the disappointment of losing her fiancé, Sidonia returned along with her sister to live with their brother, who was managing the family estate. After Ulrich, her brother, got married, the sisters were forced out of their family's properties and later were hounded by creditors owing to Ulrich's mismanagement of family funds. Sidonia then traveled around looking for a place and man to settle down with. She lived in Stargard, Kripiku, Chakwili, Resko, and Marinoa. With mysterious fires occurring at the properties she lived at in both Stargard and Resko. In 1604, she was transferred to the convent in Marinau, where she was initially given a position of deputy superior, but this was taken away from her as she was seen as a negative influence. She engaged in multiple conflicts with others living at the convent, some ending up in court. Sidonia became known for her love of flowers and herbal medicine. She began to surround herself with animals, and people took this as further evidence that she was, in fact, a witch. In 1619, she was arrested and charged with 72 crimes, including murder, witchcraft, and sexual contact with the devil. About 50 witnesses testified against her, but it wasn't until she was tortured that she admitted her crimes. She was found guilty of being responsible for 9 deaths, but because she was a noblewoman, she was granted beheading by sword before her body was burned at the stake. This has been the story of Sidonia von Bjork, a very interesting life and an even more peculiar death. In present-day Cincinnati, the neighborhood of South Cumminsville boasts a population of 801 and a strong upper-middle-class community. But in the early 1900s, it was the site of five brutal serial murders that were never solved. These became known as the Cincinnati Streetcar Murders or the Cumminsville Killings. Background to Cumminsville in the 1900s. South Cumminsville had been the southern portion of the independent settlement of Cumminsville until the late 1860s when the town was incorporated and then integrated into Cincinnati in the 1870s. In the late 1890s and early 1900s, owing to the reputation of Cincinnati as a boom town, the area was known for a growing population of German Catholic immigrants and African Americans. These people primarily lived on Folly and Drummond Avenue. The first victim. On the day of April 30th, 1904, Mary McDonald had left her home on East 7th Street, where she lived with a Mrs. Finsley, and was seen by several witnesses near Chester Park. The 32-year-old then went to see friends, the Stagmans, who lived on Knowlton's Corner. John Stagman later claimed to have driven Mary back into the city around 11 p.m., dropping her off at College Hill, Main Street, and that was the last that anyone ever saw her alive. The following morning, Mary was found dying on a railway belonging to the Big Four Railway Company. A freight engineer had rushed her to the city hospital where she was said to have stated her name before dying of her injuries. Doctors identified a large bruise on the back of Mary's head and the more obvious fact that her left leg had been severed below the knee. It appeared she had also been robbed of her belongings. Initially, police theorized that she had been murdered by someone on one of the city's trams who may have thrown her from it. The alternate theory was that Mary had gotten drunk and stumbled onto the rail line before being swiped and injured by a passing train. The case hadn't progressed by the time of the second murder. The second victim. Louise Mueller had been last seen at a socialist rally in South Cumminsville, listening to a speech just a short distance from her home. She was later found the same day of October 2nd, lying in the weeds along a well-known lover's lane in the area. Police knew early on that Louise had many men in her life and had planned to visit a particular lover named Frank Eastman when she had left the rally. Her body was found to possess two large wounds down the front of her face, and her skull was fractured. Police would later question if Louise had also been struck or thrown from a train due to the proximity of the railway to the lover's lane and the nature of her injuries. Third victim. 18-year-old Alma Stenigway became the third victim when her body was found on November 3, 1904. Lying in a vacant lot next to the Spring Grove Cemetery in South Cumminsville, the young woman, who was well known at her local church and had been working as a telephone operator, was last seen the day before when she had boarded a tram near her workplace with an unknown man. This was the testimony of the conductor who regularly saw her on the tram returning home. Her head had been badly bashed in with a club of some kind, along with missing teeth and considerable blood loss from blunt force trauma. A blood trail told police she had been dragged into the vacant lot after being beaten. Clutched still in her hand was a tram transfer ticket. Police surmised that she had been attacked while waiting for her transfer after disembarking the tram she was last seen on. Likely being struck from behind first and then dragged away before the beating continued. Alma's boyfriend had phoned her at work that day to ask her out that night, but she had told him she had been out dancing earlier and wanted to go home and sleep. The only noteworthy physical evidence recovered in the case was the heavy boot prints of the likely assailant that had been left in the vacant lot. Fourth victim. The murder seemed to have stopped after the third victim, though there were several unsuccessful assaults that may have been the work of the same suspect. It wasn't until 1910 that the attacker killed again. December 31st was New Year's Eve, 1909. Many businesses had closed early to allow employees to go out and celebrate. A 36-year-old secretary named Anna Lloyd left her job at the Wilbur Hanna Lumber Company when she was seen 20 minutes after this waiting for a tram near Spring Grove Cemetery. Her body was found the following day near the railroad tracks. She had been gagged, her throat cut, and she had been badly beaten. Police believe that she had been attacked while waiting for the tram before being dragged away, but had managed to fight her assailant due to her great physical strength, and caused them to kill her with a bladed weapon that may have been a butcher's cleaver. Lloyd's satchel was found over a mile away from her remains. All the money she had on her at the time was gone. This was considered by the media of the time to be the point of the investigation when the slayings began to be more seriously investigated. Racial tensions began to grow between the African American and Germanic populations of Cumminsville, while the local council offered a reward for information in the case. The fifth victim. On the 26th of October, 1910, the fifth victim was identified when Mary Hackney, a 26-year-old married woman, was found dead by her husband and a fellow lodger in the boarding house they were living at in South Cumminsville. Mary had been brutally hacked to death with an axe, her throat cut, face smashed, and multiple slashes administered on her face and body. Police quickly established that the murder had been the only motive, as nothing was taken from the house. This time, the police had more physical evidence to work with. The murder weapon, a bloody axe, had been left behind, while a bloody thumbprint had been left pressed onto the doorframe when the killer had left. Police had taken the unusual step at the time of draining a nearby canal in the hopes of the killer's belongings being disposed there, but nothing else was found. The attempted murders. When the initial 1904 murders were happening, there was a multitude of attempted murders that the police later looked at more closely for information to aid them in their investigation. A Miss Clausing was attacked while on her way to a party one night. She had just crossed a bridge on Elmore Street, South Cumminsville, when a man came at her out of the darkness and tried to snatch her purse. The attacker struck her with an axe several times in the head before leaving her for dead on the railway tracks. A group of men later found her still alive, and doctors managed to save her life. Miss Clausing's father was a local gardener who didn't come forward about his daughter's ordeal until after the third murder in 1904. On the night of November 6, 1904, Mrs. Winnie's heard a knock at her door around 11 p.m. When she answered, a man asked her for food and she refused. She then went out to the backyard and was grabbed from behind by a man she believed to be the same individual, and screamed once before he stopped her. At the same time, her husband, who had gone out to the local pharmacy, returned home early and heard her scream. He attempted to confront the assailant, but they fled. Mr. Winnie's fired several shots at the assailant with his shotgun during the encounter. The daughter of American architect Samuel Hannaford was the next victim. His daughter, Dorothy Hannaford, had left her meeting of the Young Woman's Christian Association and headed for her home in Winton Place, South Cumminsville. While she had stood waiting for the tram to arrive near the Spring Grove Cemetery, a short, rough man jumped from the undergrowth and grabbed her arm. While Hannaford was screaming and struggling with the assailant, a tram suddenly approached and he fled, leaving her unharmed. Just an hour after the attack on Dorothy Hannaford, her neighbors Miss Unkback and Mrs. Hagerdorn were set upon near their home. When one was grabbed by the arm by a short man, the other hit him about the face until the man released her, and then both women beat the man until he fled the area. The day after the discovery of the third victim's body, three young women, the Weimer sisters and Mammy Roddy, were passing the Spring Grove Cemetery when a man stepped from the undergrowth near the graveyard and began to attack them, pinning one of the girls down as he beat the other. The girls managed to overpower their attacker and pulled his hair before gouging at his eyes, causing him to flee back into the graveyard. The following night, Mrs. William Wergel, her mother, and Mrs. Robert Kelly were passing through the woodland that borders the back of Spring Grove Cemetery when a man they believed to be the Cumminsville killer approached them. The woman screamed and fled the area in the direction of the busier streets. The man didn't attempt to follow them. On November 17th, a Mrs. Gerbig reported to the police that she had been attacked twice by the same man near the vacant lot next to the Spring Grove Cemetery. She told them she had managed to fight the small man off both times and returned home unharmed. On the night of November 22nd, 1904, Mrs. Josephine Hewitt was passing Spring Grove Cemetery when a man emerged from behind the headstones and attacked her. While he attempted to strangle her, she punched him in his left eye before drawing a revolver and shooting at the man. Once he had fled, she hurried home and contacted the police. A search was carried out, but nothing was found in the area. Police believe that these many setbacks and close calls in 1904 may have been partly the reason for the killer stopping his attempts until 1910. The suspects. All the survivors of the 1904 attacks described their attacker as a short and heavily built man who wore a dark slouch hat. These eyewitnesses all gave different descriptions, however, when it came to race, as many described their attacker as white, while the others said he had a dark or possibly black complexion. Henry Cook. Cook was a prime suspect as he worked as a butcher and had been identified by two local girls as having fled the scene of Lloyd's murder. According to records from the time, he was arrested and bail was set at $1,000 by the magistrate. However, no further records exist of what became of him, and it's widely believed he was later released because of a lack of evidence. George Lewis. Lewis was a Marine firefighter who had been arrested for a series of minor offenses in the years before the murders. He was arrested and questioned about the crimes, but was described as being vague about his whereabouts during the 1904 crimes. He was later confirmed to have been in prison at the time of the 1904 murders in nearby Hamilton. James Fields. Fields remains to this day the only black man arrested in relation to the crimes. He was arrested at the same time as Lewis and Cook, but like Cook, no record exists of what became of him. It was likely believed he was also released without charge. Harley Hackney. Hackney was arrested on suspicion of having murdered his wife when he found her dead in their home in 1910. His fellow boarder, Charles Eckert, was also arrested and questioned. He was later compelled to remain in Cincinnati to give a testimony at his wife's inquest, but this led to no charges being brought against him. Charles Eckert was held for less time than Hackney and was swiftly released because of a total lack of evidence against him in the case. Herman Schering. Schering was a milk float driver who was arrested at the same time as Hackney and Eckert. The reason for his arrest was not given, but it was believed by many that he may have been present at the scene when police arrived and was arrested as a precaution. He was later released without charge. The Dayton Strangler. From 1901 until 1909, an unknown killer had murdered 5 women in Dayton, Ohio, in a manner described as identical to the Cummingsville killer. This has led many to believe that the killers were the same individual, and despite a mentally disturbed man claiming responsibility for the Dayton crimes, the case is still considered unsolved to this day. An unnamed black man. Almost a week after Lloyd's murder, a black man arrived at the home of David Taliaferro in Ford, Kentucky. The man had a bloody knife with him and yelled out that he had murdered Anna Lloyd before fleeing. A posse led by the local sheriff is believed to have failed to find the man, but no official records exist in the aftermath behind the initial report. Richard Finley. A black man named Richard Finley was also arrested in 1910 near the scene of the Hackney murder and was held pending further investigation. But like so many suspects in this case, a lack of further reports about them suggests they were also released without charge. Conclusion. The Cummingsville killings occurred more than a century ago and are more than likely to remain unsolved forevermore. Do you believe a likely suspect wasn't looked at closely enough by police, or did the killer elude identification entirely? Why do you believe they stopped in 1904 only to kill twice more and then vanish? What do you think?